Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the panel discussion, Where Are You From? The panel discussion is an outreach program as part of the exhibition titled Lokame Tharavadu, The World is One Family. That's a global survey exhibition conceptualized and curated by Bose, Krishnamachari. It brings together the artworks of more than 260 Malayali artists from India and abroad in different venues of Alappi and Ernakulam. The core idea of this exhibition, The World is Our Home, drawn from the verses of the Malayalam poem written by Vallathol Narayanan, appeals to the universal spirit of humanity, especially at this crucial juncture, where existence is marked by confinement, reeling under the pressure of the global pandemic. The exhibition invokes the transformative potential of art and attempts to revive and resurrect the dejected human spirit. The project is an outcome of the special interest of the Kochi Biennale Foundation to reach out to the artistic community in these challenging times. Contemporary times are also fraught with dangerous sectarianism that the artist community may counteract by rallying together to inspire, renew hope, and foster a global outlook. As you know, this is our sixth panel discussion. And all throughout this series, we have been grappling with the issue or the question, where are you from? And we are trying to expand to, by asking this question to expand the notions of belonging, identity, fixity, and home. As you know, it's a very basic and simple question, where are you from? But one always answers with a hesitation and a pause. When we ask this question, where are you from? Are we looking for a simple one-word answer? That where am I from? Am I from Kottayam? Am I from Tiruvalla? Am I from New York? Where am I from? The expectation is that it demands the answer of a locality, a place, a point on a map, where I or anyone else can place ourselves in order to satisfy the curiosity of the person who is asking this question. But the problem is that the times we are living in, the global age we live in, and in the modernity that has made us highly mobile individuals, so these two conditions makes it increasingly difficult for us to pinpoint a dot on a map as defining our experiences, our feelings of belonging, our origins, and all the matter of life that constitute us as individuals. So in times when maps and national borders are no longer as simply definable as they used to be, this question should elicit answers that are far more than a single word can relate. And that is why we have today with us the four panelists who will discuss how their ideas of memory, fixity, non-fixity played an important role in their careers. And they will speak their ability to move and to form through this movement, how personal subjectivities were formed. And today evening, we have with us Bose Krishnamachari, who is the curator of the exhibition Lokame Tharavadu, and he is also the director of the Kochi-Muziris Biennale and the president of the Kochi Biennale Foundation. Thank you, Bose, for joining. And I think this is after a long pause that we are doing this, we have restarted the series again, and we have three different interesting participants today to take forward this particular theme. Annu Palakunnathu Matthew, her photo-based work is a striking blend of still and moving imagery, and her work draws on archival photographs as a source of inspiration to re-examine historical narratives and colonization's legacies. Matthew's recent solo shows include the Royal Ontario Museum, Canada, Nude Blanche Toronto, and CPI NYC. Matthew has also exhibited her work at the RISD Museum, New York Art Museum, MFA Boston, San Jose Museum of Art, Museum of Fine Arts, Victoria and Albert Museum in London, Kochi-Muziris Biennale in 2018, PhotoFest Biennale in 2018, and Gwangju Photo Biennale in 2009, as well as its Smithsonian. She has an upcoming mid-career retrospective at the Newport Art Museum in the fall of 2021. All the best for that, Annu, and thank you for joining today. Annu is also a professor at the University of Rhode Island and was the director of the Center for the Humanities for 2013 to 2019 and the 2015 to 2017 Sylvia Shantley Professor of Nonviolence and Peace Studies, and is represented by Sepia Eye Gallery, New York City. Welcome, Annu, to this panel discussion today. We have Blaise Joseh, who is an artist, educator, art educator, and a farmer from Kannur, Kerala. He has a BFA in sculpture from MSU Baroda, and an MA in philosophy from Madras University, and a bachelor's in theology. After completing 16 years of a formation as a Jesuit in the Patna province, Blaise Joseh moved out of the religious life to pursue art and lived 4 years of a nomadic life, exploring and engaging with various communities as an artist and art educator. He has been involved in community-based art projects as an art consultant and facilitator to several research-based funding organizations like NEG FIRE, F-I-R-E, New Delhi, Oxfam, American Indian Foundation, Indian Foundation for the Arts, Quest Alliance, Bangalore, facilitating art workshop projects and also developing art-based modules and curriculum for schools, learning communities, and various social organizations across the country for past 12 years. Together with his artist partner, Athrey Day, he has worked extensively with communities and learning spaces in tribal-dominated government schools, educational institutions, orphanages, prisons, and family spaces in several parts of the country. His interest in social and environmental issues have led him to documenting people's memories and histories of people's movements like Narmada Bachao Andolan, Kandan Kali Samaram, memories connected to rivers in various parts of India. Since 2018, Blaise has been the programs manager of the Art by Children program of the Kochi Biennale Foundation, where he designs and coordinates its art room project, which is being conducted as an online program under the name Learning at Home program during the pandemic. And Blaise and I were discussing how this is the first time we'll be also discussing about how bringing art into the home. And that's going to be a crucial discussion, especially during the pandemic. So look forward to your presentation, Blaise, and thank you for joining us today. T.V. Santhosh, born in Kerala, obtained his BFA in painting from Shantiniketan and master's in sculpture from MS University, Baroda. T.V. Santhosh has acquired a major presence in the Indian and international art scene over the last decade with several successful shows with many international art galleries and museums. Santhosh's recent sculptural installation from Passage to India is in the Frank Cohen collection at the Initial Access. Some of his prominent museum shows are titled Collector Stage, Asian Contemporary Art from Private Collections in Singapore Art Museum, Singapore. The Silk Road, New Chinese, Indian, and Middle Eastern Art from the Saatchi Gallery at Tri-Poster, Lille, France. Dark Materials, curated by David Thorpe, GSK Contemporary Show at Royal Academy of Arts, London. And India Zhenzai, MOCA, Shanghai, China, Museum of Contemporary Art, Shanghai, China. Then Passage to India, Part 2, New Indian Art Form, the Frank Cohen Collection at Initial Access in UK. Santhosh was also part of the 2016 Kochi-Muziris Biennale, 2012 Havana Biennale, and 2011 Moscow Biennale of Contemporary Art. Thank you, Santhosh, for joining today, and look forward to your presentation. So let's start with Annu. Annu, please go ahead with your presentation.
So we were asked to present today on the question, where are you from and how that affects your practice? The question I often get is, where do you really come from? How does really change the way one views the question? For me, it points out that I'm not the norm and don't belong. Now being older and wiser, I've started to embrace my transnational experience, which allows me to be both an insider and an outsider in multiple countries. It gives me a perspective, a different perspective, which influences my practice. So to give you some context, I was born in England, grew up in India, and now live in the United States. Being transnational and calling a number of places home allows a certain understanding and closeness to my culture of origin, yet there is a distance. This is illustrated in one of my earlier projects, Memories of India, which is about the scents and smells and gestures that remind me of my home culture. I photograph with a Holger plastic toy camera. One of the reasons is because the plastic lens vignettes the edges and distorts the image more like a memory. Many of the images have people in them, but they're usually silhouetted or at a distance. So the images show an awareness of the culture, but it also shows a distance. Unlike this one, which shows a certain intimacy, as these are my mother's feet. Moving on to spatial memories, which is in this exhibition. The images reveal the vulnerable interiors of houses that were literally cut in half to make way for the widening and expansion of highways. These disfigured houses suggest the uprooting of the one-time inhabitants, and they trace a collective map of cultural memories in their vulnerability. The images question whether India will hold on to some of its history and culture, or will these cultural shards be replaced with the adoption of most things Western? Something that I think about personally too. Globalization has parallels to colonization. Are there other ways to globalize without losing one's identity? Is the question that the work brings up. My larger work starts from images that are familiar to most people, which allows the work to be more accessible. I'm especially drawn to family photographs for what they initially present and what they often hide. I create what I call as photo animations, where I collaborate with two or more generations so that the same family moves through the frame, collapsing time. By showing multiple pieces equally together, the hierarchy and differences of caste, state, and religion collapse. After creating these photo animations across different countries, one collaboration in particular with a Holocaust survivor brought my focus back to my cultural homeland. It brought the focus to the children of partition, whose personal stories we, outside of those communities, rarely learn or hear about in India or abroad. This is the story of the Kohli family from India. I went from being wealthy to a penniless refugee. My father went back after 2 years to his home at Lakshmi Mansions, flat number 39. The person living there had a British mother and a Muslim father. The man asked if he would like a cup of tea. My father said, when I was served in my silver tea service with my monogram on it, I realized that I was homeless. After returning to the United States, I realized that I was only telling one side of the story, and I think this perspective comes from being transnational. And so I spent the next couple of years doing the same collaborations with families that had moved during partition to Pakistan and Bangladesh. And so this next piece is Nazreen's story. When we moved to Pakistan, we stayed with a family friend. His neighbors were a Sikh family. They said they were going away for a few months and said that my aunt could stay there. They never came back. One of the things that struck me about listening to the stories from India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh was that everyone spoke about this longing for home. And the closest word that I can find for it is called hiraet. It's a Welsh word that has no direct English translation that even starts to describe it. It's a mixture of longing, yearning, nostalgia, wistfulness, all for their original homes. Going back to the question, where are you from? Or where are you really from? I think I'm really from all three countries where I have lived, England, India, and the United States. And over time, I've realized that my larger work also looks at the colonial reverberations from the past that still exist today. That is a loaded statement that, because of the 8-minute limit, I can't tease out further today. But you can see more of my work at annumatthew.com. It's Annu with two N's, Matthew with two T's. Thank you. As I had initially mentioned, having lived in multiple countries, it makes me both an insider and an outsider. And I was starting to show the regeneration project, which is in the exhibition. And I actually did that collaboration with different families across different cultures. And when I collaborated with a Holocaust survivor and her family, it made me refocus my attention on the history of my cultural homeland, which is India, where in terms of partition, those outside of those communities that were affected by partition really never know some of the heartbreaking stories and experiences they've gone through. So I applied the same process of the regenerations and created pieces on the children of partition in India. When I went back to the United States, I realized that I was only telling one side of the story. And again, I think that comes from being both an insider and an outsider. And so I expanded the project to also interview and collaborate and create these photo animations with families from Pakistan and Bangladesh. And then the last body of work I was going to show, I'm blanking on right now, in the end, where I'm really from is all three cultures, and all of them definitely influence my perspective and the kinds of things I'm interested in. And I think initially my work started from my own experiences, like an Indian from India. But as I've, become older as an artist, it's also become telling other people's stories and collaborating with other communities.
Thank you, Annu. Thank you. Thanks a lot for the three presentations. Blaise, I think you go ahead with your presentation.
Okay. Thank you, Boseh and Premjish and Lokame Tharavadu program for inviting me to this panel discussion. I find Lokame Tharavadu is a great initiative to bring so many Malayali artists as a collective, not just to showcase artworks, but also to create discussions, conversations, and also thinking together and dreaming together. And I'm very happy to be part of this collective. Moving on to today's topic of the discussion. I was 17 when I left my childhood home to live my life as a Jesuit priest. I joined the Patna province of the Jesuit order, thus making Bihar my second home. In the years of formation, I kept moving from house to house, finding many houses as my home, because for a Jesuit, no house is a permanent home. For a Jesuit, the Jesuit order, the community of Jesuits, and the people who one engages with become home. Eventually, it means as a Jesuit, you have to find home within yourself. Eventually, I left the Jesuit order to live an independent life as an artist. In the following 4 years, I lived a nomadic life without a permanent home. I travel back and fro India's rural areas, particularly the inter-border areas of interstate border areas dominated by tribal community, to develop different art-based education programs. One of the communities that I engaged with for several years were the Musahars, one of the most socially oppressed communities in India. During the art workshops, I noticed how home was one of the most prominent and reoccurring themes in the images the children of the Musahar community drew. As one of the lowest castes in India, the Musahars are condemned as the most polluted and polluting people, with the consequence that they are allowed to build their houses only in the extreme northern part of the village. As landless laborers, they don't have easy access to the required construction materials, such as bamboo and tiles, to build their tiny and minimal houses. I noticed how their drawings of houses were different from other children's drawings of houses, which inspired me and the children to explore this topic in more depth. Together, we started transforming a specially designed bus into a home by painting the bus with large, colorful images of mythological figures of the Musahar community, all visualized and illustrated by the children themselves. It was an attempt to claim an identity for those who otherwise are denied of the basic dignity, even to have a livable house. This engagement with the idea or concept of home continued to be a central theme in my work with different communities. Together with my artist wife, Athrey Day, over the coming years, I recorded people's stories and memories connected to their homes and their homeland. Several of my drawings and paintings that are now displayed in the Lokame Tharavadu exhibition are inspired by these stories and memories. Many of these stories were stories about the loss of home. One of my images, Portrait of a Migrant Worker, shows a washerman who left his home to make a living in the city. And he lives just behind Athrey's house. Several other images, such as My Home Was Right Here, are based on the stories and memories of people that Athrey and I engaged with while joining the Narmada Bachao Andolan. While these are stories and memories of individuals, they exemplify a phenomenon thousands of people experience in this country, especially those from the lower strata of our society. Mining, corporate farming, building roads and setting up factories and other infrastructure projects throughout the country have forced people to leave their homes. Mega projects of the corporations facilitated by governments have no regard for the lives of tribals and Dalits. They take away land and push men and women, children out of their homes and dignified lives. How can tribals, Dalits, women, children, and LGBT be at home in a country where they are, where they have no dignity and where they have no freedom to be fearless? Can this nation be called a home for a majority anymore? Is it not all the more a need for this majority to struggle for and claim their rights over the denied at-homeness? The paradox is that at the same time, governments claim to build houses for every citizen, a large section of our population experiences the loss of houses and home on a daily basis. While this is undoubtedly the most extreme form of losing home, also otherwise people lose connections with their home. In our fast urban and technology-driven world, people are not only being separated from their homeland, but also generally from their context, soil, and nature, and of late, because of the pandemic and the lockdown, also from people. I have been trying to address this problem in the Learning at Home program that I'm coordinating for the ABC program of the Kochi Biennale Foundation at its root by working with children and their families at home. While the project is an art educational program, its aim is not to make professional artists out of the participants, but to deepen creative perspectives in the children and their families. One important aspect of this process is to create a non-judgmental, non-competitive, and fearless environment. It is more important for me that the children engage in creative interactions with their home than the children merely learning techniques and skills of drawing. Living as a Jesuit as well as working with the different people and communities has also made me think about my idea of home. What I realized is that for me, it is not the physical structure of the house that gave me the feeling of home, but people, communities, land, and places. 3 years ago, I decided to return to my homeland to stay, to feel the home in the land I grew up in, to reconnect to the people I grew up with, and to relive the memories I have with the river I grew up with. After the new land act has been passed in the parliament, I have begun to wonder about how long I can withhold the ownership of this land and soil. For the moment, I'm holding on to it and reclaiming my home through my art practice with a resolution to hold on to it. I'm not only engaging with my work in this manner as a central theme, but gaining the colors that I use from the soil. In my latest works, some of which are at display in the Lokame Tharavadu exhibition, I am engaging with my home. I document my family members, neighbors, land, and the river in my work, narrating my and their stories and memories. Thank you.
Thank you, Blaise, for that very charged presentation and a very politically relevant discussion, not only about home, but also about homelessness and displacement. And I'm sure we'll have many questions in the coming session too. We will discuss this further. Santhosh, please go ahead with your presentation.
I have wrote down a little bit, some thoughts basically. So I will read it out first, then there are a few images. Maybe I can show them later. Already, there are many people have already spoken so well or deeply about exploring the idea of home from various perspectives. I don't know, I'm not sure whether I would be able to add anything specifically new about it. Perhaps if we are looking for a definition, then one can arrive at multiple interpretations of it. If you translate the original Sanskrit phrase Vasudeva Kudumbagam into Malayalam or any other vernacular language, then though its essential implication may remain the same, etymologically it may differ from one language to other. And each translation could be expressing a certain cultural specific meaning. I even hear that there are no equivalent phrase in some Indian vernacular languages. And the difference between English word home and the Malayalam word Tharavadu could be something quite interesting to be explored. Well, a home is a residential space. It may be a permanent or temporary one, but it is a space to which we always have an innate tendency to return back. It is a space where we feel at peace, secure, or being loved. It may be a place where we have a sense of belonging. In that sense, it is both a physical space as well as emotional one. It is not merely a place of residence, but it is a place defined by our nature of relationship with that space or objects, memories, and the people living there. But if you consider the home as a source point or origin, then it can be quite very problematic or can generate a number of philosophical questions. It is depending on where do you want to start and where do you want to stop the tracing. Maybe one can stop it at a place where we are born into, or maybe we can stop it at our mother's womb or at the moment of inception. If you look at from a karmic point of view, one can possibly travel thousands of past lives backwards. In some Indian spiritual philosophy, the source is emptiness. A quantum mechanist might show us a path into the realm of subatomic particles, or even to the beginning of a Big Bang. Possibly, this process can take us to an extent of our imagination. Even an environmentalist can look at the idea of home as a planet, Earth, from a larger ecological point of view. But if someone on the street asks me, where are you from? Then I think I wouldn't be interested in making things complicated. I would simply say my postal address. Each approach is equally valid, and when all those viewpoints are put together, it will make an interesting tapestry of ideas. When we talk about home, we also in a way need to address the issues of homelessness, of underprivileged, victims of partition, people displaced in the name of progress and ethnic cleansing, or the people who are found themselves to be outsider in their own homeland due to now narrow nationalistic policies, people in the detention centers or refugee camps living as second citizens. When you consider this as a space with its specified boundaries, then it becomes a political issue by default. And in a way, if we keep extending that boundary and play it with ideological imagination, then the nature of its politics also change. Its focus can shift from personal to social, local to national, and then to the global level. Someone had said that in a deeper level, social divisions breed fear and hatred for others. The divisions between caste, religion, and race, and the borders between nations have been marked with the histories of deep wounds inflicted by man against its own kind in terrible ways. Would a world without borders be a beautiful world than the world we know today? Or is it just another kind of utopia? In other sense, today, in the era of information technology, we might not need to physically go out in search of the world out there. The whole world comes into your living room through news reportage. Or rather, the whole world travels with you wherever you go with the electronic gadgets you carry along. World is home with its conflicts, never-ending chain of revenges in the name of God or in the name of nations is going on. All this somehow becomes integral part of our everyday experiences and eventually get absorbed and reflected in our works we do. Like someone has said that man is his past. His consciousness is defined by all the informations, experiences that he collects over thousands of yesterdays. In fact, the self and the world is not opposites, but the world is an extension of the self, or the self is an entity which is sharing its undefined borders with the world around. And maybe I can show the image later, but I'll just read it out. The work I am currently showing at this show is an extension of a series of works I had started some years back. In a larger context, these works have resulted out of my ongoing preoccupations with understanding the history in relation with the war and terror that shapes our current reality. Besides, it's also a result of rediscovering my young days. A few decades back, when I used to make posters for a reactionary group and had been actively part of several street theater productions. Like in an one-act play where the protagonist interacts with the objects that determine the progress of its narrative, I choreographed the act of the protagonist in order to shape-shift his identities and identities through history and its landmark events. From an army personnel to political prisoner, from an activist to a victim, he transformed to tell the stories with the help of various props, ranging from weapons, prosthetics, pawns, rat trap, handheld flags that are sold on streets, toys and nooses, and so on. Each of those props are laden with the multi-layered association and stories that we hear on everyday basis. The stories about hate speeches, border issues, atrocities committed by men in the name of religion, its eventual human displacement and suffering could be unfolding as the narrative progress. All those issues have in some ways or other consistently crept into my works in various junctures. The work title as Your Land and My Laboratory, I had done this work in 2003, is about how America always did their nuclear experiment outside their main territory. The work title as Nation, Fear Nation and False Promises, done in 2004, talk about how borders represent fear and hatred. Also, how countries can manipulate informations to attack another country in the name of protecting the world from the terrorists, so-called terrorists. You were terrorist, you were our freedom fighter. So one of the work I had done in 2004 is about ongoing war that is happening all around the world and its problematic stance on human rights violations and the idea of nation. Or the work title is A Room to Pray, done in 2008, History Lab 2019, deals with the angst of looking into the future through an apocalyptic vision of this world, as if the world on this show, and one of the few other images that I mentioned in the notebook. Yeah, this is the work, I think this is the only work I have in the show. I could only manage one work. And I'll show you some of the details of it. It's a watercolor on paper, a large scale one. And this is the one I just mentioned I had done in 2003. Title as Your Land, My Laboratory. And this is another work I mentioned in the same note. And this is another piece. It's a one installation I did in 2007. It's another view of it. Some details. So one of the very recent work I have shown in the last Delhi Art Fair. Yeah, that's it. And I think that's enough. Yeah, one more detail of it. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you, Santhosh. Mainly for revising the notion of home. And also because it allows, it becomes capable of both recognizing the structural and the national differences, and also engenders the artwork and the artist to move out of them and think beyond these kind of boundaries and confinements. So thank you for that, and we will discuss more in the coming session. But this exhibition, one of the important features of this exhibition is that it's not only restricted to artists who are geographically, physically located in Kerala. It has also expanded outside of the nation state of India too. When did you make that decision? And also there are also many artists who are not technically Malayalis in that way, but they identify maybe Kerala as their home, the language as their home, the culture as their home. So what do you think about it?
So I would say that I am a Mumbaikar Malayali or Mumbaikar Mallu. You know, the same context I look at it, you know, like people, if I look at Kabita Mukhopadhyay or some of my friends who their parents are, you know, maybe somebody is from Maharashtra, mother is from Kerala, you know, this kind of intermingle, all that kind of stuff is there, you know, like for us, when we were talking about the talent scouting on, you know, like the contemporary Kerala Malayali artists from around the world, and I could connect with a lot of, for example, Mahesh Baliga, he's neighboring state of Karnataka, and he speaks Malayalam, and he lived with a lot of Malayali artists in Baroda. And originally, there is no blood relationship or blood connect with Kerala. You know, so Mahesh is an exception in the show, and there are many other artists as well. I was looking at artists, you know, there are so many talents always when we were looking at. You know, this was, I never realized that so many talents are existing or working in a contemporary art scene in, you know, from Kerala or, you know, outside Kerala as well. Some of the friends we are really familiar about in Delhi or Mumbai and, you know, like outside, whom so are making, you know, because they got opportunities to show their practices. In that sense, we are all familiar with the outside. More than inside Kerala, I was really familiar with outside world. Their practices shown in gallery spaces, you know, or museum spaces, or travel together, or something or the other. In that sense, but you know, like finding, looking at overall picture about a Keralaite artist, you know, like. The travel really made a lot of interesting points to find the new energies and new ways of seeing and practices. And this also I mentioned earlier when I was looking at the practices of Keralaite artists, it's really different kinds of schools within that small land, you know, like I could find, you know, there are quite a lot of surrealist thinking to a lot of new age thinking, new practices as well. So this you cannot really find it in any other state, you know, like I was talking to many other friends, you know, like also traveling, you know, and I was looking at it. I felt that, you know, there are so many talents, so much of different kinds of diverse thinking from the homeland or, you know, like homelessness. You know, like I was really interested in, you know, like three of our artists were talking about the, what is home. And, you know, basically it's all come from some ways memory. Memory is very much connected to everybody's practice. So, you know, like this was also mentioned earlier, then when I was started thinking about this project, I had only 140 artists in my line, my list of exhibition. But the research one by one started, you know, a travel from Kasaragod to Trivandrum. I really found, and also some of our friends said, why don't we check it out, these artists? And, you know, like, most of their studios I have visited, you know. And, you know, there are cases, special cases, Prabhakaran's wife, Kavita Mukhyopadhyay, or, you know, like, artists who lived here 35 years, Gayatri Gomez. All these people, you know, Gomez comes from Spain and, you know, like, lived and worked in Kerala. And now in some part of Chennai, in Madras. So I was looking at, you know, that really, you know, simple answer is that, you know, what is that the best thing is provided by Kerala? It is not the space. I think, you know, when I talk about the space, it is not the gallery I'm talking about. It is the space where they had some kind of connect that's reflected in their practices. And definitely the thinking is also really, really valuable in that sense. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bose. And also thank you for mentioning the common thread of memory in three of their works. And that is very fascinating. Annu, let's start with you. Zarina Hashmi has in fact said that you can never go home again. I don't feel at home anywhere, but the idea of home follows me wherever I go. I couldn't help also looking at your WhatsApp status, which says that I am an Indian from India. That's your WhatsApp status. And somewhere the compass of home, even though you claim to be part of these three cultures, it's, I think it's focusing towards India. Why is that?
Actually, I mean, that's a really good point. I mean, I think my status is an Indian from India because in the US, because people can't distinguish what accent I have, and if I say I'm Indian, they think I'm Native American. So I have to distinguish myself from the Native American. So that's where it came from. And I happen to live at India Point in Providence. So I actually like to say that I'm an Indian from India who lives at India Point. But to your quote, it actually reminds me of one other thing that I mentioned in my presentation, is that when I was hearing the stories from the children of partition, there was from all of them, from both sides, all three sides, there was this longing for their childhood home or that place where they grew up. And it's more than just nostalgia. It's, and I found a word in Welsh, which is called hiraeth, which means, you know, longing, nostalgia, memory, it's everything combined in one. And apparently there's no one word translation in English. And I think that also relates to an immigrant's experience. And in a way, I've been an immigrant twice, you know, coming to India and then going to the United States. And so, but then I don't have a longing for England as much as I do for India. And I think that's partly my, you know, upbringing, both parents being Indian, And also, I mean, very, you know, crucial years living in India during my teenage years. I think critical time that really influenced who I've become.
I don't know if it's right, but there is an exilic subjectivity that is operating in this work, and also generally in the in the narratives, and also the artist figure who is approaching all this is approaching it from an exilic position or an expatriate position. Is there a difference when you approach it from claiming or being in India and from outside of India, of all these issues, colonization in your work, excavating colonial photography, and then showing the kind of regime of power in those images, and looking at partition, looking at the history of military presence in the early 20th century, in Indian military presence in Italy, and that particular history. How does it differ?
I don't think I would call it exile. I think I would call it, for example, when something's too close to you, you can't look at it very logically because the emotions come in the way. And I think because I also have that distance from the culture, that I'm also, willing to, I think I have a bit of a love-hate relationship. I mean, growing up in England and then coming here, I did have issues about the difference between, about the patriarchal society. And I have done work about that. And so I guess I'm willing to maybe tackle some things that are not black and white in my artwork. And I don't really see that as from an exile perspective, but more from a, again, going back to the insider outsider perspective. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Annu.
Thank you.
Santhosh, I wanted to a very, very wonderful, a monologue which you presented, and many, many viewers have really impressed by that. One thing is that, as I said earlier, you have revised the notion of home, and that has allowed, the presentation has allowed to look at and recognize the structural differences which exist within the nation and also outside of it, and kind of imagines the possibility of moving out of these structures. And one thing which I've also noticed is the productivity of memory in your work, and the role of memory in your work. And you have constantly, your work has also foregrounded the memory as a very productive force, not only for the individual, but also for the nation. This is not the conventional memory. Like Toni Morrison, the African writer, she has said that the memory has to become re-memory, which means that it has to acknowledge the importance of imagination in dealing with trauma. And this suggests the fluctuating mobile status of identity. How important you think memory is in the current context, where the memories of many things around us are slowly getting erased and destroyed? How important it is to preserve home, it is important to preserve memory.
Yeah, basically, essentially, memories are, in a way, history itself. Maybe when you say history, it's a collection of memories. Several people over the centuries. In my work, a lot of the works actually deals with the, you know, the history, especially the kind of works I had done during the period of almost 5 to 10 years, like 2000 to 2010. Almost all the works have something to do with the the idea of history, actually. Probably it is because I have been looking at a lot of books that gives you a certain sense that what happened during the First World War and Second World War, especially those black and white photographs. Those are the kind of source materials that really inspired some of the paintings that I had in, during that period. But apart from that, when you talk about home or a homeland or something like that, then I don't know whether home as a nostalgia or a land as a nostalgia it's not really there in my words, you know. But rather, the kind of experiences that I had when I was in Kerala, especially when I was studying Trishur, my associations with a certain group of people and their activities, or you know, especially I would like to say a little more clearly in the sense. When I studied in Trishur Fine Arts, they basically taught everything that is very much, you know, something to do with you know, how you can develop your skill and things like that. Mostly the kind of academic style and so on and so forth. But when you come out of that institution, when you talk to the people around there, then you realize that, you know, whatever you are doing there and whatever you are learning there is not really in something that going to make you a creative artist. So there are a lot of conflict between the kind of things that you are learning in that institution and the kind of cultural situation that is there outside that institution. It was a period of very interesting period, I mean, in the middle of 80s, probably a culturally very interesting period, very intense period in that way. The kind of friends you had, or the kind of people you had a kind of, you know, acquaintance with, they all talked about the kind of, you know, idea of art, which is very much, you know, very much left oriented. Something that you know you wouldn't probably understand or learn from in the classrooms. You know, so it's, that time they were basically talking about the kind of aesthetics which, you know, something completely different from what you learn in the classrooms. So,
Blaise, yeah, I'll come to you quickly. And so there is a sojourn, there is a kind of a journey which has taken place from going towards and trying to explore spirituality as an abode and then shifting from there and leading a nomadic life, which is actually, again, I think part of certain spiritual sects too, leading this kind of nomadic life, moving around and being like this wandering figure. and working with communities is also like very much part of the modus operandi of these religious sects too. But this is a secular kind of wandering, the secular nomadism. And in also your writing there and what you presented, there is this deep angst about homelessness and very critical, careful, cautious warning about the need to address this. Would you try to elaborate more on what your current practice is trying to do, especially about the protest movements and all, and what they are about and how you are involved in that?
I shouldn't claim that I'm actively part of any of these movements, because of course I've been introduced to all these movements as a Jesuit, and I continue to be connected to many of these movements in different states. But I know that I'm not an activist of that sort. I always looked at those movements or those realities as an artist. I don't know if I'm floating, so I wouldn't like to make any claims, okay? But I'm still part of all those movements. And what my role is to look at the current history or the current reality through the living people, through the eyes of living people. You know? So my role is to document their memories, and if possible, convert those memories into different forms, which can be shared with larger societies. But since I have been mostly moving around, I did not actually get into a serious practice of converting or transforming these memories into different forms which can be shared. It's only now I think I'm actually settling and then looking at documentations, those memories, because I am also at the moment, I'm also like addressing certain crucial issues like land and the possibility of the absence of land. Even in my workshops, what I try to encourage people is to connect to their realities, because we are actually living in a very fragmented world where we are encouraged not to connect to your immediate context. No? You're always encouraged to aspire to something that is beyond you, your context. And in many cases, you are actually encouraged to look at your own context in a very, content manner. So it's important to connect to your own context, to document memories of people, document diversities in your own context. So these are the things that I'm at the moment as a practitioner trying to do. For example, I came back to after many years of traveling or living in the North Indian states, I came back and then I looked at the river that I've grown up with. And in 2017, in the summer, I walked through the river for almost 3 kilometers, and I could see that most of those sites where I could remember have disappeared. So it was important for me to ask the people living along the river, what has happened to the river? You know? So it's important to remember to reconnect to the river. And so it's a process of documenting people's memories connected to the river. So I'm connecting to my own river because I've been part of, say, a river movement like Narmada Bachao Andolan, where people are forced to move out because there are huge several number of huge mega projects are coming up. So yeah, that's all.
What I also noticed in your presentation was you said when you're talking about homelessness, displacement and all, you're talking about they losing their context. Context is something you have, again, in your answer right now, also you have mentioned that the context which is getting lost is a very tragic affair. And I think we all are seeing that again and again, playing out in the political reality of India, how the context, which is very localized, or which is very immediate to us, is taken over slowly by a larger, grand, homogeneous context. And it is imposed on us. What we are seeing also in the Lakshadweep and all that, we are seeing that. And it is where you are trying to also work with very young minds who are not what you call, do not have a kind of a rigorous training or anything, but you're involved with these young minds to work freely and bring art to their homes. Does this art create any context for them? Does it familiarize them with their local histories, their surroundings? What does it do? What does your project do?
So the activities, I mean, so the practice of this this project is to introduce not just children, but also adults to primarily connect to their own context, because the starting point of any creative thinking or creative expression is your own context, actually. No? So, for example, introducing children to or the adults to the soil in your own courtyard, different shades of soil, something that we projected as dirt. Many people would say that's dirt, but it's actually not dirt. But documenting different shades of soil is actually the beginning of maybe drawing itself. Because any child given the freedom, it would actually start with playing with the soil, not with crayons or oil pastels. So that's a fundamental material. And so also looking at leaves, or patterns in the nature, and you're familiarized, you know, you're building a relationship with your own context, which is actually often negated. I've seen in North Indian states and all, children are not too, well, children would look at their own context as something which is very negligible, very, I mean, it's not something that you should aspire to live with. And there, when you're introducing them to their own context, to engage with different kinds of materials, different kinds of thoughts, also with people, people's memories. It's a different kind of perspective that they develop. And the byproduct of those processes may be visuals or of different sorts, or even documenting in the form of videos, audios. That varies, actually. So, yeah, that is the process of introducing learning at home. And it's not an individual program. It's actually a collective program. Actually. So when a child is looking at his or her own context, it's not just in isolation, but also automatically that child will be engaging with the other members of the family also, you know? Because that context is actually a collection of various people and their memories as well. So, yeah.
Bose, I think you have to say something.
When it comes to Kochi Biennale Foundations, one of the most important vertical, I would say, you know, other than the Biennale and Students Biennale, this ABC program is now it is known as Art Room Project, but it's learning at home. I was part of, in the sense, you know, whenever I get time, I used to attend it. You know, it's really one of the best curated program, I would say, in this period of time, the pandemic period of time, coming together with the family and, you know, like sharing, learning from grandpas and grandmas and, you know, listening to the stories and also Blaise's ideas, how it can be really, you know, liberated or experienced or experimented, explored the land materials or the near materials like, you know, clay to soil, as he was mentioning. It's really interesting, you know, like I really believe that this coming together of family and learning with the children, not only learning with the children, you know, so I think that I attended some family from Canada, some family from Germany and some from Dubai and other places, and also definitely from neighboring state and neighboring, you know, districts. So it's really nice to see how education, you know, from that learning at home is one of my favorite program right now as an educational program, not only making people, all kinds of people aware of what's the values of, you know, learning at home through, you know, I would say culture more than art. Yeah.
Thank you.
And he's doing extremely well with those families and, you know, like really connected, reconnected. You know, it's growing, that relationship, you know, which is important, I think. Yeah.
Thank you, both. Coming to both Annu and Santhosh, there's a common thread, I think, which connects their practice is how they approach images. Both of you have a very critical stance towards images and how you use them, appropriate them, quote-unquote appropriate them, and also repurpose them, reenact them, whether in Anu's case it is photography, past photographs, archival photographs, archival images, and in Santhosh's case it is media images. Both of you have a very similar but different areas of engagement and different ways to reflect on it. So again, memory, this critical stance towards images and how image has been used to construct a particular identity, a particular way of belonging, a particular way of what you call nation state, has been, you both have been consistently questioning that idea of home, memory, image making, and that also circulates in our what you call art and education field. And also in discourse making about home, about culture, about identity. And underlying all this, there is a violence, which you have also exposed in different ways. Like in Anu's case also, there's a patriarchal violence, which is exposed. Santhosh's case, it is the largest structural violence, the violence of the state, the violence of imperialism, that is also out there for us to see. Any observations on this aspect from both of you, Anu and Santhosh, your engagement with images and how you expose this violence?
I think I go back to what Santhosh said, which I look at it as more as relooking at history, which includes memory. And, you know, there's always multiple narratives in history, depending on who writes it, and it's usually written by the person, the whoever wins. And so I think there's always untold histories that are in parallel, that sometimes illuminating them can create more empathy and better understanding. I think one of my other reasons for using archival images actually connects to what I love about Blaise's work, where he's making the work really accessible to a larger community. And, you know, seeing a family photograph is something that most of us are very familiar with. So it allows a very easy entry point for the viewer then to see what I've done with the photograph and hopefully change their perspective or learn something new about our history or someone else's history through the piece. So part of the reason why I use the archival image is for that accessibility reason. And also, you know, people say that photographs never lie. I actually think they do lie. And we choose what we put inside them or don't. And everyone poses very happily for a family photograph. It doesn't really tell you the truth behind that family.
Thank you, Anna. Santhosh.
Yeah, I think that in my case, it's almost like an investigation into the whole history of war and violence. Yeah. Because you every day get up and see the newspaper and start seeing such imageries. Can you hear?
Yes, please go on.
So it's, in my case, it's almost like an investigation into the history of war and violence. Because it is through the kind of news media reportage that you look at the world and the reality. Because the news media reports or the kind of imageries that they generating out of out there have the kind of potentiality to manipulate and reconstruct the kind of idea of reality in whichever way you want. Because if you really look at even the same story, you know, covered by two different TV channels, will be having different kind of political, you know, implications. And so that, you know, it is more about how an image or an image that you recorded from the reality can be manipulated in such a way that you change the whole understanding of reality. You know, that is the kind of very core point of my work. So in that sense, like what Annu said, that you know, the photograph, even though it is a kind of a documentation of a particular moment in the history or a particular moment in the reality, can say certain elements of reality, but at the same time, maybe it may not be completely true. Because there can be a lot of mediation of a photographer's viewpoints or his past experience or even his political lineages and things like that. So my works basically deal with those aspects of how an image can be manipulated in whichever way you want it. And how can, especially a news reportage image, have the potentiality to reconstruct the idea of reality. That is the core element of most of my works, basically.
Thank you. Thank you, Santhosh. And I think we are running late of time now. So let's conclude the session. And thank you, everyone, for participating today and taking out your time. Anu, your connection has become very clear, fabulous. Looking like a 4K resolution right now from the earlier one.
I just want to end with a funny story. Bose called to invite me for this exhibition, and I thought he'd accidentally called me, and I never returned the call. And so he had to call me two or three times before I realized he was actually trying to contact me. So I apologize for that, Bose. So, but thank you all.
Thank you for being part of this exhibition, and it is wonderful. It's unfortunate that, you know, like some part we cannot really show. Last week we had a live walkthrough. We will do that maybe live show very soon. Other parts of the exhibition, we could only show 30% of the show last, you know, 1.5 hour program. And, you know, also given a lot of, it's also, I wanted to say, some of the collectors really want to pick up the work from the exhibition, and they're really excited to see the diversity of the practices shown in the project, you know. So, yeah, these are the kind of notes I get it, and I'm really happy that hopefully some of the artists will show their projects other part of the world, and so not really gone out from their native places. Yeah, so really confident about this coming together of this show. Thank you so much, Santhosh, Blaise. Lovely to see you, Annu, and Premjish. You always do a fantastic job bringing them together and, you know, moderating, coming with the new ideas and new suggestions and new perspective in Lokame Tharavadu. The world is one family. Love you all.
Thank you both. Thank you. Thank you, Rohana.
Yeah. Thank you, Bose.